Nau mai, hara mai, tena koutou, tena koutou, tena koutou katoa. My name is Reverend Gareth Walters, and together with Rev Josh Jones and Rev Kate Berkeley, it's my great privilege to welcome you all here to this service this morning. Of course, it's the first service in the season of Eastertide, where we celebrate and rejoice over the resurrection of Jesus. But more than just being an Easter greeting, this news that Christ is risen actually carries for us implications for a new way of living, a radical mission of God. Missiologist Christopher Wright puts it this way when he describes what the Bible has to tell us about this mission. He says, "The Bible renders to us the story of God's mission through God's people and their engagement with God's world for the sake of the whole of God's creation. The Bible is the drama of this God of purpose, engaged in the mission of achieving that purpose universally, embracing past, present, and future, Israel and the nations, life, the universe, and everything, and with its center, focus, climax, and completion in Jesus Christ." See, mission was not made for the church, but the church was made for mission. Of course, as Anglicans, the world over recognized this call to a new way of being and this invitation to participate in the resurrected life of Christ through what we commonly know as the five marks of mission. These are something that we've shared about previously, in fact, when we first took on the role as co-vicars 4 years ago. These five marks are so critical, though, that we decided to revisit them, particularly in the light of what we've been all facing in these recent days and months. You may remember that when we looked at this and these themes, these five marks of mission last time, each of those five marks of mission were categorized by one word, a word beginning with the letter T. The first of which is to tell, to proclaim the good news of the kingdom. The second is to teach, baptize, and nurture new believers. Thirdly, the call is to tend, to respond to human needs by loving service. Fourthly, to transform, to seek to transform unjust structures of society, to challenge violence of every kind, and to pursue peace and reconciliation. And lastly, fifthly, to treasure, to strive to safeguard the integrity of creation and sustain and renew the life of the earth. All of these five marks of mission sum up what it is to be involved and participate in Christ's resurrected life. Well, this morning, our co-vicar's warden, Bryan Parry, will be sharing about the third mark of mission, responding to human need by loving service. A theme in the light of what we've been facing couldn't be more appropriate. So as we begin, let's share in this opening call to worship in this Eastertide. Itafano Atakaraiti, we celebrate the resurrection, the first fruits of new creation, new beginnings, new shoots, and new hope. Loving God, your new world has been unveiled to us in Jesus Christ, and we are invited to belong to it. God's new beginning for humanity, making ritual water gospel wine, cleansing all our worship. This is the good news. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never put it out. The grave is empty. Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. And the verse for the day comes from St. Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 3, beginning at verse 7. "So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who makes things grow. The one who plants and the one who waters have one purpose, and they will each be rewarded according to their own labour. For we are co-workers in God's service. You are God's field, God's building." Amen.
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness. promise of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. Give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. Singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. Singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Today's reading is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 10, beginning at verse 25. The most important commandment. One day, an expert in religious law stood up to test Jesus by asking him this question: Teacher, what should I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus replied, What does the law of Moses say? How do you read it? The man answered, You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Right, Jesus told him, do this and you will live. The man wanted to justify his actions, so he asked Jesus, And who is my neighbor? Jesus replied with a story. A Jewish man was traveling from Jerusalem down to Jericho, and he was attacked by bandits. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him up, and left him half dead beside the road. By chance, a priest came along. But when he saw the man lying there, he crossed to the other side of the road and passed him by. A temple assistant walked over, looked at him lying there, but he also passed by on the other side. Then a despised Samaritan came along, and when he saw the man, he felt compassion for him. Going over to him, the Samaritan soothed his wounds with olive oil and wine and bandaged them. Then he put the man on his own donkey and took him to an inn where he took care of him. The next day he handed the innkeeper 2 silver coins, telling him, "Take care of this man. If his bill runs higher than this, I'll pay you the next time I'm here." Now, which of these 3 would you say was a neighbor to the man who was attacked by bandits? Jesus asked. The man replied, "The one who showed him mercy." Then Jesus said, "Yes, now go and do the same." This is the gospel of Christ. Praise to Christ the Word.
Tēnā koutou, good morning. I'm Bryan Parry, Vicar's Warden of St. George's, who, like you, is getting used to being part of the ungathered faith community during the lockdown period. If it's any comfort to you, the resurrected Lord first appeared not in a cathedral or mountaintop, but to a group of frightened, fearful followers in lockdown. Now, recently, my 3-year-old granddaughter Lucy and I were having a fluffy date in a cafe. In the course of our conversation, the wee chatterer raised today's topic of compassion this way. She spied a fishing magazine with a snapper on the cover. Lucy confided, "I wouldn't eat that fish, Pop, I just pat it and stroke it." The other day, the wee soul spied a dead cockroach on an outside path at her house and enthusiastically informed her mother that she was off to get her play doctor set to make it better. Now, some viewers may find the following image disturbing. There was an immediate tense standoff between them about the advisability of this course of action. Lucy relented, comforted by the thought that the cockroach was with Jesus. And my daughter's wry reflection on this incident was that tender-hearted Lucy was definitely at the cutting edge of compassion. It's my duty to guide you today on reflecting on one of St. George's 5 missional foundations, responding to human need and loving service. Such an appropriate theme for this unprecedented time. Now, as retired as I am as a doctor, I've seen many remarkable examples of loving service over the years. An example in my area was a nurse-led team by a superb charge nurse in the surgical ward at Auckland Hospital, dressing the challenging abdominal wounds of patients with intestinal failure, wounds complicated with leakage of intestinal contents. And these demoralized, often broken patients, the loving expertise, the protracted, gentle, patient care done with cheerful good humour was moving to observe, and I honour them. Over the past weeks, we've all seen brilliant examples on our screens of such loving, costly care of COVID-19 patients by clinicians of all stripes and nationalities. Now, in the Christian faith tradition, loving, costly service has always been a revolutionary consequence of being a follower of Jesus Christ. Although Christians don't hold monopoly on compassion, of course, wherever geographically and historically the Christian message has spread, acts of mercy, medical, social, and educational have inevitably followed. Loving service, however, is not without its difficulties. It's costly, and it's not for the faint-hearted. Sometimes the recipient of a highly intentioned caregiver can be frankly hard to love. Sometimes people can be hard to help, as they seem to prefer holding on to grievance and enjoy the victim role rather than taking advantage of any proffered help. Their distress can indeed be taken out in anger and blame towards the very person trying to help them. And some even feel entitled to and to even exploit the offered loving care. The result is that the caring person can be worn out, disillusioned, and even withdraw with pain and even cynicism. Indeed, a sense of weariness and well-doing is not an uncommon experience when care is offered. On the other hand, genuine suffering people in their pain can be hypervigilant in detecting the true motivation behind the person offering care. If service is done out of detached obligation or stoical duty, this is only too obvious to the hurting patient. They can read the carer like a book. Some, through giving care, are addressing their own deep woundedness themselves, of needing to be needed. And this can be picked up by the person receiving the care. Sometimes we can, in our misguided zeal, offer more than our design capacity can reasonably stand and justify this as self-sacrifice or noble self-sacrifice. However, the truth remains that compassionate service done appropriately and from true motivation and acts of personal cost, we can be honourably wounded. So, what can we learn from Jesus Christ's life and ministry in responding to need in loving service? When you look in the Gospels, there are about 26 occasions when Jesus healed specific individuals, in addition to what I term the informal clinics undertaken throughout his extensive travels. Based on these and other encounters, the following qualities in Jesus emerge. Compassion. He looked on the crowd with compassion because they were like sheep without a shepherd. He wept over the tomb of Lazarus. He was moved by the widow of Nain's dead son. He had compassion, it's recorded, on two blind men who were seeking him out. He was humble. He didn't trumpet his healings. He often instructed his people not to tell anyone. He was respectful of where people were coming from. The man at the pool of Bethesda was asked, "Do you really want to be healed?" And then Jesus had to patiently hear out his grievance that there'd be no one to help him get into the water in time. Jesus set boundaries for himself. He was often away alone in prayer. He took effort to avoid the crowd on occasions, come apart and rest a while. Lest in a while you come apart, you may have heard as an adage, a good one, I would say. And Jesus' care was costly. He felt the strength drain out of him when the woman with menorrhagia touched the hem of his garment furtively to be healed. He was non-judgmental. When the religious priests asked, did the blind man, was he blind from birth because he or his parents sinned? And neither, said Jesus. When the woman was taken in adultery and her accusers slunk away in shame, Jesus said, no, neither do I condemn you, and to sin no more. He risked displeasure with the establishment, healing on the Sabbath, and challenging them as to why he should not do that out of compassion. And he got into trouble as the Son of God for pardoning people's sins along with their healing. He didn't expect gratitude when the 10 lepers who were healed went away to get signed off by the high priest. Only one returned, but he was not offended. He was compliant with health policy requirements of the day and got the healed lepers to always sign off with the high priest. And all the while, he was mentoring and instructing his disciples and the onlookers. For example, a legal expert once approached Jesus wanting to know how to procure eternal life. And Jesus answered, "You're to love God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." The lawyer, trying to deflect the uncomfortable directness of the reply and the radical demands, resorted to the old slippery trick of questioning the semantics of the word neighbor. Well, we're glad he did, because Jesus gave him and us the sublime parable of the Good Samaritan, which we heard read earlier. Ever since and for all time, this has defined the nature and quality of meeting human need with loving service. The incapacitated, wounded robbed traveler in a remote location by the side of the road is discovered and cared for by a stranger of different ethnicity, even though two religious leaders of the traveler's own kind have studiously avoided him and abandoned him. The kindly stranger then transports him to an inn and sets him up for convalescence, picking up the tab and promising to cover any shortfall at the next visit. And the searching question of Jesus, "Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hand of robbers?" And the lawyer can only say, "The one who had mercy on him." "Go and do likewise," he says to him and to us. And one who's famously gone and done likewise, showing mercy, is of course Mother Teresa. She understands it this way. "I see Jesus in every human being. I say to myself, this is hungry Jesus. I must feed him. This is sick Jesus. This one has leprosy or gangrene. I must wash him and tend to him. I serve because I love Jesus. She's picking up Jesus' words at the conclusion of Matthew 25. It gives us the astonishingly down-to-earth but profoundly demanding answer to the questions posed by the inquirers in the story. When they ask, Lord, when did we see you hungry or feed you or thirsty or give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger invite you in or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you ill or in prison and go to visit you? Truly, I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. And as C.S. Lewis reminds us powerfully, there are no ordinary people. You've never talked to a mere mortal. Next to the blessed sacrament itself, your neighbour is the holiest object presented to your senses. Accordingly, no act of loving service can be seen as large or small, significant or insignificant, and no recipient more or less worthy or more or less strategic. Mother Teresa again. I see God in every human being. When I wash the leper's wounds, I feel I'm nursing the Lord himself. Is this not a beautiful experience? So to respond to human need in loving service is to see the risen Christ in the people we serve.
Loving God, as your people and your church, let those words from Bryan be our mission prayer and our heartbeat, to see the risen Christ in all the people we encounter. As we look around our communities, our nation, your world, we see many neighbours who have fallen by the wayside and are lying at the roadside. We see those who are the victims of violence. We see those who are neglected and left all alone. Those who have suffered the wounds of trauma, emotional, physical, and spiritual. We see the unclothed, the unprotected, stripped of their dignity. We see those who are suffering most from the ravages of COVID-19. All in need of Christ's compassion and mercy. All in need of someone to stop and take notice and tend to their wounds. So, loving God, we pray for a world that remembers and lives out those words of Jesus Christ. Whatever you do for the least of my brothers and sisters, then you are doing it for me.
In this time of world crisis, let us be a people, a church, a world that shows the Spirit of Christ to all who are in need. And where our hearts may be hardened, let the Spirit of Christ turn them tender again. And where our hearts would want us to cross to the other side of the road to avoid our neighbour in need, challenge us. And like the Good Samaritan, let our compassion and mercy have no boundaries of race, colour, or religion.
Loving God, we pray for those who are caring daily for someone, and in their sacrifice of love, pay a cost. Give them strength and encouragement to find the reserves needed to carry on their loving service. We pray for all those who have lost their loved ones to COVID-19. Comfort them as they mourn. We pray for those who are meeting this huge human need at this time, especially in the hospitals. In their moments of fatigue and of their fears, strengthen them with your restoring, guiding presence.
Loving God, in the repercussions that are still to come, and all the hardships and challenges that will fall on so many, we pray for the least of our brothers and sisters, those who will feel the hardships the most. Fill the hearts of all world leaders and all people to meet this human need, and let us not leave anyone to fall by the wayside, neglected and ignored.
And loving God, for us, as followers of the risen Christ, remind us of St. Paul's words to the Corinthians. that we are co-workers in your service. Empower us, we pray, through the power of your Holy Spirit to serve your mission of restoration in your world. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. So thank you so much, everyone, for joining us this morning. It's been good to be together again. As I listened to Bryan, I was reminded of Mother Teresa's quote that says similarly, it's not about how much you do, but how much love you put into what you do that counts. This idea of loving service is so important as we seek to express this resurrection life of Christ together. And so as we go with God's blessing. May the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon each one of you and all those that you seek to love and care for in the name of Christ our Lord. So go now to love and serve the Lord. Go in peace. Amen. We go in the name of Christ.
Jesus, you're the Lord.